So hi everyone, welcome to Node.js Interactive. This is a talk about will React hooks replace Redux. My name is Trivikram Kamat. I had prepared this talk around 9 months ago, and this was selected at the last moment. I'm not actively working on React, so some things might have changed, but I will tell you what has changed. My Twitter handle is Trivikram, and GitHub handle is TrivikAR. If you notice, I didn't get Trivikram handle on GitHub. That is because I joined GitHub pretty late in 2015, and the Trivikram handle was taken. So if you recently become parents, then get GitHub handle for your kids. It worked. That is more important than any other social media which you are on. So if you are active on social media and want to tweet about this talk, then the hashtag is hashtag Node.js Interactive. And since this talk is about React, hooks, and Redux, you can use those hashtags too. Use these hashtags if you like the talk. If you did not like the talk, then use my name. But what's my name again? So you're in Canada, and in Canada it is pretty cold. So you know this type of alcohol. It's rum, it gives you warmth. So imagine a weak rum. Not a strong rum, a weak rum, and add three in front of it. That's my name. So, oh, this one also worked. But that's it. Yeah, thanks. So, what are we going to learn? So, we are going to learn what is React State and why it's not enough. Then we'll learn what is Redux and React hooks. Then we'll go through a simple to-do app from Redux, and we'll replace Redux with React hooks. So, let's start. So, what is component state? So most of you who have used React would be knowing what component state is already, but some of you might be new, so I'll spend some time on this. So state is just data. A state for an application might change based on things such as user actions or response from an API. Now what are user actions? User actions are something, you click something and something needs to be updated. That's a user action. What's a response from an API? You click something and some data needs to be fetched from the backend, which takes time, so that data is stored in the state. So an application will read this state to determine what sort of user interface to show. Okay, so now all of you are at Node.js Interactive, so let's see the example app, which is a shared event scheduler app for Node.js Interactive. Note that shared doesn't use React, so I don't know, I just checked the web. The React, it was not showing React. I'm just using that as an example because you would have used it. So if you go to the info tab and you reload the info, then the loading bar comes. Okay, that is user action. So the user action will be is loading. So is loading is true, then show the loading bar. If is loading is false, then show if data is loaded already. Then if you see user data, that is if you go to my account, then it will show you your account details. So the state, if it was using React, it will store your account details like your username and password, it should not store, but then username and some other things. Or event data. All of you are here for this talk. And if you are seeing the talk page, then talk title, talk description, speaker name, this will be stored in the state. Now, when React state is not enough, when an application is simple, state management is trivial. So this is from a Medium article. It's amazing. Do go and read it if you're interested. So when application is simple, state management is trivial. But as application gets complex, application state is spread across multiple components. And the functions that update the state also get spread across many components. So in the beginning, you're very happy. And when your app becomes complex, it becomes difficult to manage the state. And to have an overview of the application state, you need to have a mental model of the application structure. So if some new developer joins, it will be difficult for the developer to understand what the heck is happening. Okay. So it becomes harder to trace state changes when debugging. So in the GIF or GIF which you are seeing, the purple color change is a state change. So when state change is initiated, it has to be populated to the parent so that it can be propagated to the children where state needs, the UI needs to be changed. So you have to pass all this state back to the parent, you have to pass the state to the props, and yeah, it's, if you have used, if you use component state in a complex application, you'll realize. So what is Redux? Redux is a very common tool used in React applications for managing application state. And it is predictable, it is standardized, it is centralized, it is debuggable, and it is flexible. This all you can read from the Redux website. We'll just see what, how the application state changes, how Redux changes the state management. So what Redux does is it allows you to maintain application state at a single global store rather than in local component state. So in the previous GIF, you were seeing state was stored in two parent components. And then it was just like, you know, some magic was happening. Here there is a single global store. So for Redux, if you are new to Redux, this will be a little difficult to understand, but I'll try to simplify it. There are actions. Actions are payloads of information that send data from your application to your store. So in the GIF, you will see the state chain initiated the purple dot, that's an action, which goes to the reducer. Reducer specifies how an application state changes in response to actions sent from the sent to the store. So when the reducer is operated, reducer will call the store to change the global state. And what does store do? Stores the whole application state. It allows access to state via get state and many other things. Okay, so what are React hooks? Hooks let you use state and other React features without writing a class. So they are completely opt-in. You can try hooks in few components without rewriting any existing code. So don't worry, you don't have to relearn React. It's 100%, they have 100% backwards compatible. So hooks doesn't contain any breaking changes. And they are available now. They were released in React 16.8 in February 2019. So let's see an example of React hooks. If you want to open this example on Code Sandbox, you can click picture of this QR code. So here we have a class button which has a render function which shows the button. On click, it calls handle click. And handle click updates the state. State is initial, state has a value counter which is initialized to 1. When it's clicked, it just updates it to 1. So what I will do is, oh, it's not showing me. Oops. I copy pasted and that thing disappeared. Anyway, I'll show you the other demo. So this is how React hooks changes the code. So you no longer have class. There is a function, and you no longer have the state and calling this.setState. You get count and set count from useState, which initializes it to 1. And then it has a button on click, it just calls setCount, and it increases the counter. So we'll be able to see this code. Yeah. Actually, if I copy this in my history, this is, yeah, YP, this one. So this is the one with class. Yeah, this is the one with class. And you just click on it, it just increases the counter. And this is the one without class. So it's just count, set count, and that also increases the counter. Let's go back to the presentation. So we will be wondering, are classes being removed from React? No. See, I wish they did. But then, because classes confuse both people and machines, and there are so many issues with classes, but classes are not being removed from React. If you like classes and happy with it, use them. Don't use them. But do I need to learn React again? No, because it's a gradual adoption strategy. So what React team is trying to do, they're just trying to throw and see if hooks get popular. If they get popular, they'll stick. And maybe they'll deprecate classes in future. So hooks will provide a more direct API to React components you already know. That is prop, state, context, refs, and lifecycle. So let's learn hooks by replacing Redux. There's a Redux to do app. If you want to see how it is structured, you can click this QR code. But I am going to go through it. So let's see some code. Because talking is boring, right? So I open the ES code. I'll just increase. Okay. So this is our app. This is for showing Redux dev tools. So this is our app. So it calls app. App is in components. It calls add to do. Okay, let me run this first and show you how it looks. So this is a to do app where you add to do. So crack GitHub parents joke. Okay. Crack Trivikram. Oh no. It's Trivikram. Joke. And show demo. So I've cracked this too, and I'm now showing you the demo. So let's go through the code. So this is add to do. This is visible to do list. So if I say active, it shows me the active to do's. Complete to do's, all to do's. And the footer is this entire thing. So if I go to add to do, you will see that, let me hide this, okay. So if you go to add to do, you see there is a form. On submit, it gets data which is entered. It dispatches the add to do action. If I go to add to do action, what it does is that it tells that I'm calling add to do action type. ID is the next to do ID, it adds it to one. And the text, which is gets from the add to do component. Then we go to, let's say, filter link. Okay. I'll show you. So that is add to do. In app.js, let's go to footer. In footer, it calls filter links with three links. Visibility filter, this is an enum, which has three values, that is show all, show active, and show completed. Okay, it calls filter link with the visibility filter, so that if I click this, that is a visibility filter passed. And in filter link, this is map state to props, map dispatch to props. It's like very difficult to understand. If you worked on Redux, you'll realize. So it calls the link component. In the link component, it has a button. And on click, what it does is, in filter link, it calls the set visibility filter action. What set visibility filter action does, that it calls the action type set visibility filter with type filter. Okay, so let me close this and we'll go to the slide. So what we are going to do now is we are going to learn hooks by replacing Redux. And if you want to see this GitHub repo, how it is done, you can visit this link. In the README file, I've explained step-by-step process on how you can replace Redux with React hooks. But in this case, I have a video because you should never do live coding. If you're giving conference talks, never do live coding. So let's see the video. Okay, this video was shot in January of this year, so I'm installing the next versions of React. But now you don't need to do that because React 16.8 has hooks. So what I do is I create a new folder called store. So we are not using Redux store anymore. And I create store context. Store context is where your context, React context will be stored. So I'll import create context from React. And then I'll just call create context and return the data. You can return some initial state also if you're storing this data somewhere in local state or in the database or something. then I'll create a store. This should be, I actually call it provider, but let's call it store right now. It's a higher order component. So I go to store folder and create store.js, and I import React and use reducer. This is the first hook we are using. Use reducer from React. So this is supposed to replace the Redux provider. So I'm going to export a function because for classes. So that function provider will take one use reducer call, and the use reducer will take root reducer, which you pass to Redux, and the initial state. How do you get initial state? By calling the root reducer. So I store initial state in initial state and return store context.provider. This will create the provider for me, and I pass a value to it. That value has a use reducer call, which takes the reducer you get from the function which is calling this component, that is root reducer. And second thing is initial state, this is optional. And of course, you're getting children from the call, right? So you're using those children, you're passing those children. So this is the diff, if you take a picture. So we have store.js, where we create a new store context.provider, and we have store context.js, where we create new context. So, people taking pictures. So I'll go next. So replace Redux provider with store. So how do you do this? So now we were calling provider from React Redux, right? We have to call store dot, because store calls store context.provider. And we pass the root reducer to that store component. And we don't have to import React Redux or Redux anymore. So we just remove the React dependency. This is how the diff looks. Now we have to remove Redux from individual components. So we saw add to do component, which used, which got dispatched from the parent. So we remove connect because we don't use Redux anymore. We remove the call to connect. And instead of getting dispatch from the parent, we are going to get dispatch from use context hook. This is the second context, second hook we are using. So we call this, use context and pass store context to it, and it will give you the dispatch function. This is a dispatch function you call. So now you don't get any value from the parent. So use context and pass store context to it. And then, this is how the code looks. And in filter link, this is how we remove Redux. So I told you about map state to props and map dispatch to props, right? It is no longer required. Because we are going to import React and use context from React. And we are going to create a new component which will pass these two values. So what map state to props and map dispatch to props does is map state to props will get the state and pass the prop called active. So if it gets filter prop from the parent, it checks if filter is same as the visibility filter in the state. And onClick will check, onClick will call the set visibility filter operation on set visibility filter action. So here I just check for if filter is equal to visibility filter. And onClick, I just copy paste what map dispatch to props were doing and remove own props, because now we are going to get filter and set visibility filter from use context. So we call use context and we get the values for visibility filter and dispatch function. And to use context, you pass the store context, which stores your React context. And you remove map state to props, map dispatch to props. So this is how the code looks. You don't have, no longer have map state to props and map dispatch to props. So similarly, same thing needs to be done on visible to-do list. I'll not go through it. So let's have a demo and see how this looks like. So escape. And I go to VS. I switch to git checkout hooks. So here, we made some changes. So let me show you add to do, which no longer gets dispatch, and you get dispatch from use context. Similarly, filter link, which gets visibility filter dispatch from use context. So I just say yarn start. Okay, and show Redux to do demo. Replace Redux with React hooks and show React hooks demo. See, we are done. I've shown you this. So we go back to the presentation. So this is a very important question, right? Should you switch to React hooks tomorrow morning? No, because debugging support in hooks is available in DevTools, but it is not as good as that of Redux. So let me show you this because it's easy to understand when you see it. So I cancel this. I switch to Redux DevTools. I say yarn start. This app is running. I'll open the Redux DevTools and I tell them show to the right. Okay. Okay. Now I'll just write, I don't have anything to say, test 2, test 3. Okay, so this is the debugging support for Redux. So you go to this add to do action, right? If you want to jump to this action, you can jump. You can jump to this action. You can skip this action. So debugging support for Redux is amazing. And that is what you're going to miss in hooks. So I git check out hooks and say yarn start. I close this. I'll wait for it to load. Ooh. Know why this happened? Because I'm storing data in the local storage. Anyway, so how do we debug here? You go to, so one advantage is that you don't have to install Redux DevTools. React DevTools will do the job for you. And I just add test 1, test 2, test 3. Okay, and I can see values here. But what if I want to jump to some value or skip some value? I could not find this option, but then I don't think it's there. It's, at least it's not intuitive. So that is what you're going to miss. So debugging support is not good, and middleware is not yet available. So if you use Redux, then you will have used some kind of middleware for like Redux Thunk or Redux Sagas or Redux Observables. That is not available. But developers have welcomed React hooks. You can visit, there were 1600 comments on RFC. So do give it a try in your side projects first. So will React hooks replace Redux? Imbon, you came for this answer, right? Okay. So, and answer is, like, it depends. I'm sorry. most of the conference talks which have the title question mark, right? Answer is it depends. But let's say what is happening. React team is recommending libraries to export their own custom hooks, such as use Redux. And React Redux in version 7.1.0 supports hooks API and exposes hooks called like use dispatch and use selector. And even React router, if you use it, it supports hooks since version 5.1. So React is known for building user interfaces. It is not known for state management. So not sure if React team will try to replace Redux. But then it's exciting time to be in JavaScript world. Thank you for listening. This is my name, and Trivikram Kamat. And you have GitHub repo here. Yeah. Thanks.